The last leaked document about what's called the PRISM gate or the NSA gate, in which the world discovered how the United States is spying and surveying people online through social media, email accounts, Skype, etc. And it's a huge discovery for the netizens of the world to understand that they are being watched and that they should react on that. For us, in the context of Tunisia, we know the lack of transparency. We know that it's tough or impossible to access some information, whether it is governmental or administrative information, to understand what's going on in subjects related to economy, to justice, to the reform of the police, security, military, etc. Not in a word, we've been working since like few months after the revolution on strengthening our investigative section on Nawaat through basing our work on leaks. We leaked tens of documents, whether related to security, military, justice. Recently, we leaked many documents related to the IMF loans. And actually, we imposed a debate, a public opinion debate, within the mainstream media, within the street, even within the Constituent Assembly, that discussed the IMF loans, which was done and dealt in secrecy. And through publishing those leaked documents, we made available those documents and this information to the representative of the Tunisian people. We heard them saying that, is it normal that we, representative of the people, should check Nawaat website to get to know about what's going on between Tunisia and the IMF? So for us, it's important to focus on leaks because it is the only way and it's the only weapon in face of a non-transparent establishment and system. So this event comes in this background situation.
So why this topic of surveillance, NSA, prison is important? Why counter power online is crucial for the online freedom, privacy, security of netizens?
I think what we saw with Tunisia, for example, when I was here last time, right after the revolution, Roger and I gave a talk, Roger yeah. Dingledine, who started the Tor project, we gave a talk at a university, and someone said, but what about all the bad people on the internet? Yeah. And so we did a survey and asked, who here has been blocked by Ahmad 404, the censorship yeah. system? And every person in the audience essentially raised their hand, yeah. including the girl that asked that question.
Yeah.
And I said, well, there you go. Here are all the bad people, yourself included. So why is surveillance important? It's important in that it is a system generally, when implemented, a surveillance system or surveillance programs, they are part of a larger program of control.
Yeah.
I mean, this is actually a thing that Foucault and many other people have talked about. So surveillance is control. So we must be concerned with surveillance because of the consequences, some of which are not obvious, that you and I associate, for example, that I associate with someone else here. It might cause them trouble.
Yeah.
There was a time, in fact, for almost all of human history, where it wasn't possible to know that without deploying people for each thing that they wish to know. And now we live in a time where American corporations beta test their oppressive technology on Tunisia and other places, and then deploy it to everywhere that the market will bear, the free market.
Okay. And what can we do?
There are several things. The first thing is to recognize that this is not a matter of technology. It's about dignity and civil society. It's exactly the same way that we get to choose whether or not we wear clothes or have curtains and what clothes we wear. Just as it is an affront when people try to regulate the choice that a person has about wearing a headscarf, for example, it is an affront to suggest that everything we do should be under surveillance.
Yeah.
So there are things we can do in particular policy-wise. But that in itself requires sometimes legal knowledge or technical knowledge. So what we should do is think about it in terms of our own personal agency. So that is to say that we should very carefully recognize that we are losing our agency and ensure that governments retain our agency. So when we know that America spies on the whole planet, each country needs to actually secure communications for individuals, end-to-end encryption, for example. But also, we need to preserve the rights of private action. We need to ensure that companies that are bound by secret laws have laws here and in other countries that force them to either choose between not serving this, for example, country or market, or not serving another country's market. Yeah. That is, telling the truth, not being gagged, not being complicit in this. Just as those companies should not have been complicit with the Tunisian Ben Ali regime, we should ensure that that doesn't happen elsewhere. Yeah. And I think that it's pretty critical to not dismiss it as something we've always known and to fall to cynicism. Journalists can't protect their sources, for example, if a journalist's promise is undermined by a total surveillance state. So for us to have the basic underpinnings of a free society, including a rich journalist protection, either under law or in civil society or in society in general, we have to actually ensure that these things are not a foregone conclusion, that we won't actually lose that. So if you are talking to a source and you protect the source, we need to make sure that the source is actually protected. You can do that with law, but we can also do it with technology. So using free software, using things like the Tor browser, off-the-record messaging, Gibberbot, TechSecure, we can make surveillance worthless by turning it into ciphertext.
Yeah.
But that's disarming to some people. It's disarming in the sense that many people don't understand technology like the law. So what we need to recognize is that we need strong defaults that protect people, where there's no so-called lawful interception and no backdoors. Because what we learned from the PRISM leaks and from other things about the NSA leaks by Edward Snowden, as far as I can tell, all of those systems are going to be subverted by the NSA. So regardless of the laws and policies of Tunisia, somebody else gets to control it.
Yeah.
So what a regular person can do is know in their heart of hearts that they are free and that they should stay free by rejecting other people's wish to be their masters, whether it's through technology or law.
Last question. What's the role of leaks in all of this story?
Well, I think what we see is that people say that things don't make a difference, individual actions. But what we see actually is that people, single person, can make a world of difference. Hadley Manning, Daniel Ellsberg, these are people who literally, with a single decision to tell the world the truth, have changed our entire perception of the world. Whether it was the Vietnam War for Ellsberg, whether it was the actual wars in Iraq and Afghanistan in real time, or whether or not it's all of the surveillance that's taking place now that feeds into it, right? What Manning showed us was the data, and what Snowden has showed us is the architecture of how that data is captured and what it is used for. And so leaks are absolutely critical. And so whether it's in a corporation or in government, when we see immoral and unethical things taking place, one person can swing the entire debate away from secrecy, away from arguments from authority, and we can actually shift it. And that is what we've seen now. And the whole world is in an uproar because it is impossible to deny what everyone already knew, allegedly. But now we know it. It's undeniable, and now we can do something about it.
Thank you, Jake.
Thanks.
And so over the past few weeks, we've seen a lot of truth come out around what my government in particular, I'm American, so what my government in particular is doing. And this conference has had a lot of discussions, great discussions about what other governments are doing. But in particular, the past few weeks, we've seen new revelations, thanks to people like Glenn Greenwald and Laura Poitras, about specifically what the U.S. is doing through the NSA, in particular surveilling the rest of the world. And so I think the conversation that we're going to be having with Jake and Ella tonight is about what's next. We're seeing kind of a zeitgeist, I guess is the right word here, between what's happening in the U.S., the leaks that are happening here in Tunisia and elsewhere. So this is an open dialogue. I'll let them lead it off, but then we'll have plenty of time for mostly unmoderated, with the exception of going you. Questions. So without further ado, I'm going to let them take the lead because these are the real experts and I don't want to say stars because this is an equal conversation, but I really appreciate them being here to talk with us tonight.
So I guess I want to start off by apologizing to the world on behalf of a country that I have a passport for the abuse that we've done to everyone. It's kind of horrific to maybe not learn the detail, because there's a lot of stuff that we suspected but have confirmed, you know, what you're doing to everyone. And I think that there's a lot of work that we as a community need to do now that we have confirmed a different picture of the world than we thought we lived in, and we need to change a lot of the tactics that we were doing. One of the things in particular that I want to say is the Net Freedom community has kind of, or for a while, has been sort of turning into the Net community. You know, it's been, well, we care about censorship, and we care about copyright, we care about things that stop people from doing things, and maybe we need to actually go turn into the Freedom community instead. And, you know, realize that, oh, no, actually, surveillance is maybe a lot more important than censorship. You know, that we need to deal with the structures that create these powers much more than we need to deal with the sort of visible consumer effects that are annoying to individuals, but don't actually stop them, don't actually curtail their ability to act in the world.
Yeah, I'm totally down with what Ellen has just said. I would probably say also that I'm actually not responsible for what has happened in my government's policy. I've tried very hard, many of the people in this room, so, like Sami, for example, who knows how to make mandarins. Always at the bank, never with whoever. A lot of people, I think, have been directly impacted by these things, but at the same time, some of us, especially some of the people in this room, I look around and I see some faces like these two, and like actually almost every person here that I've ever met before. You guys are people that have been working towards telling the world about these things for many years, and you hear a lot of white privilege, especially in the West, white male privilege, like the Eric Schmidt of the world, for example. Sorry, Eric Schmidt, I mean no disrespect. But, you know, it seems to me that we've seen a lot of that sort of pushed aside, in a sense. You know, as each of you and I have spoken up, we've been told we're crazy, we're paranoid, and so on. And, you know, it's with great pleasure that I say, I told you so. And at the same time, I want to say quite clearly, now let's do something about it. Because I think it's very important to not be cynical. And I think that the fact that we've known many of these things in our minds, in the back of our minds, and in our hearts for a long time, that doesn't mean that we should just forget about it. It doesn't mean that now we should just let it go. It means now we should actually use this moment to be humble. It's hard for me. But we should use this moment to do the right thing. So now there are a lot of people that are opening up and they're open to it, great. We should welcome them, and we should work on building alternative structures. We should welcome them in their horror to build things that are more sustainable, that are actually secure, so that instead of, say, backdooring our infrastructure, spying on people and censoring, we actually work on resolving these things, actually securing the networks, actually securing free expression, actually ending the problem of wiretapping, where the law, policy, technology, and reality are all sort of in different places. And so I think, you know, thank you to everyone that's here that's worked on this. I mean, some of you have literally overthrown governments. You've toppled dictatorships with information peacefully. And I respect that so much. I'm so motivated by that. And I hope that we can talk a bit about some of the whistleblowing that has happened lately with Edward Snowden, for example, because if there's a courageous person, I mean, he's like the Sami bin Gharbia or the Nawaat of America now, right? I mean, totally incredible for him to tell the truth about what's really going on, and at great personal cost, I suspect, which we can do to help Edward Snowden right now. And Glenn Greenwald is facing prosecution. The same is true with Laura Poitras. It is not clear what that actually means, but we have heard American politicians literally calling for Glenn Greenwald to be jailed, which is unacceptable. This cannot stand. And we all have a voice internationally. We know people in different governments, we know people in different groups, we ourselves take action that is important. If we refuse to allow those people to be hung, I think that we can really make a huge difference, not just for Edward Snowden, but for the things he wanted to actually take action about.
Question. So the culture of fear that's being created around the potential or the prosecution of Manning, potential prosecution of Snowden, et cetera, there's a lot of things in the world that we need to be more transparent about. How do we continue to encourage people to break past that fear barrier, given the environment that members face?
I think one of the things that we've seen, and it's interesting, sort of the progression of leakers, it turns out leaking is a skill set, and people are getting better at it, and that helps to a certain degree. But also, as these cases get publicity, it's understood that, yeah, you know, you're going to face, or you may face consequences for this if we can't stop that from happening. but that the ethical trade-offs are becoming much more clear, and there are lines being drawn, and supporting the shape of the world socially that we want to see creates an environment where people will do the right thing. You know, the repression isn't about those people, it's about creating that atmosphere of fear, you know, and it's about, on our end, saying no, you know, yes, it's scary, but that, you know, fear is not actually the worst thing that can happen to the world.
I think it's kind of a strange thing, and let's say that I have an intuition about this, which is to say that if many governments in the world were to stand up and say that they would offer political asylum to Snowden, if someone here has ties to a country that has an embassy in Hong Kong, that would offer him refuge. I mean, this is not the world's greatest option, as we've seen from other people like Julian. But I think that having many countries around the world stand up and say, wow, you revealed that you stand with humanity, including your own constitution, or you stand with a chain of power where you just follow up orders. And I think that that is a concrete action. So the Dutch people in this room, kick out your foreign minister and your home minister that are promoting this prison thing against your wishes, and offer Snowden the protection that he deserves and that he needs, and that without, he will probably seriously perish in a very painful way. And I think this is also true for Tunisia. If the Tunisians were to say, hey, Edward Snowden, we stand with you, we would be willing to offer you asylum, he might not take it. But if dozens of nations around the world, if all nations around the world were to stand up and say that, it really says something important to the United States and to the people of the United States about how the rest of the world feels about being treated as if basically you're subhuman. Because that's essentially what we've learned, is that if you don't hold an American passport, you are less than an American citizen, which is horrible, and it brings great shame on everyone in the United States. But we can turn that around, I think, by saying thank you and by offering help. That's a huge thing that can be done, and it's actually mostly a political gesture, I think. It will not be taken by him. But maybe he will take it if you happen to have an embassy in Hong Kong.
And it also, it very directly changes the calculations that somebody has to do if they're thinking of whistleblowing, whether or not it makes a difference in this case. All of a sudden, okay, if I can get to any of this list of countries, maybe I'm okay, you know?
I think it turns the tide also. It's not about escape, it's about recognizing that these other countries don't actually believe the quid pro quo trade of spying is worth it, or the wrongdoing is worth it. And that's, I think, the lesson that is most important, because it shows the United States, actually, that maybe everyone is a little tired of hearing about 9/11 when we have the Iraq war under our belt, right? And maybe there's something else that we should be doing, like, for example, actually upholding freedom of speech. Instead of racist scaremongering about Chinese hacking, we could recognize the Chinese at best hack machines that were fully owned by the NSA. Right? If you were concerned about, for example, Chinese hacking, you should be pretty concerned about NSA owning everything inside and out. The Chinese don't have coverage like the Boundless Informant map, as far as I can tell. And yet you hear people that are dismissing that, saying, oh, it's not a big deal because we benefit from it. And I think that we should reject that. We should reject those things entirely. And in fact, people really in this room have the power to do that.
Systems, not from behavior. Because we know it's become pretty obvious that if there is a way to corrupt a system, it will become corrupted. That there is enough money and enough intent there that, you know, I don't want to say that the solutions are purely technical. A lot of them are social. You know, what I'm saying is that the instrument of law as opposed to the instrument of mass social will and technical design is much less useful to us right now, at least within the US. You know, I'm much more hopeful about policy in Europe for changing this, especially if they decide that they start wanting to back away from data retention, to back away from some of those policies. The reaction there has been a lot stronger politically. I think there might be some hope there. But given unless there are some very significant changes within the US, I don't see that policy is going to unwind this on its own. It's going to come either from mass social pressure or from a technical inability to violate privacy.
I think, you know, I agree with you to a degree. The system itself is not completely broken. There exists in fact, the quote system of the world, many systems.
Well, the system might be completely broken. I'm not saying that it's not. I'm saying we need an ask that's like that I can go to my mom with and say, well, PRISM, look at this awful thing that's happening. Yeah. We need to change it. But we need to have something that's more tangible, that's easier to organize around than throw everything out.
Well, so I'm not suggesting that we throw everything out. I don't think anyone is suggesting that. In fact, what Edward Snowden has been saying sounds like Jefferson and Thoreau, which is hardly a throw it all out. The only thing he's willing to throw out and wants to throw out is his own life so that we can make a difference. And I think that the key takeaway that I see from this is what we have to recognize is that it does not matter if the French or the Dutch or the Germans have a political debate and have a policy discussion in their parliament. And the reason is because the NSA does not respect the sovereignty of this nation or those nations. In fact, it doesn't even recognize what the American people would want to do in an open way. And so this says to me, it is not that the policy and all the discussions are broken. It is that right now we have some systems and policies that are able to create a sort of super policy that overrides the otherwise reasonable and functional democratic systems in the world. It is not that we must tear down every parliament, not at all. We should be building more democratic parliaments. We should be ensuring that when policy is passed, that technology and strong mathematics, for example, they mesh so that it's meaningful. So that is not about tearing everything down at all. It's about building an alternative structure that complements the things we know already work, creating a thing that people voluntarily opt into, creating economic incentives for it, and recognizing national sovereignty. It's absolutely critical and key to doing this, and that's not a tearing it down, except tearing down secret law, unjust surveillance and censorship that is used in service of espionage, whether it is economic or pure aggressive warfare, which is what we have seen in the case of, say, Airbus and Boeing, where the NSA spies on Airbus in order to get bids to be Boeing, or in the case of the various wars or the drone programs. Right? These are things, the signature strikes, for example, those happen because metadata and surveillance allows people, just by looking at who associates, and then those people get killed, right? That means we need to reaffirm the freedom of association. And we need to build some technical structure for that, but we need to actually say, it is wrong to kill people based on their associations. It is wrong to not have an independent judiciary. And that's not a tearing it down system at all, I think.
Very strange, because we don't know what is legal and illegal. So, justice, yeah. What is justice?
Yeah.
What can you say? What can you say?
This
so just now like, we are free completely to do things, but we don't know when they will stop us. And they will prosecute you for something that you said. But for the fact that they are controlling us, we were living in a world here in Tunisia where everything was controlled completely.
Yep.
And now we are not controlled, or we are surely controlled, but we use that, let's say, the technology in order to get out from the control. But it was also our choice to enter in a world where everything was open. So here we are in front of a contradiction. From one side we are trying to open everything, to say everything, to construct big transparency. And on the other side we don't want others to see what we are doing. So I think that we have, let's say, a contradiction in our reality.
It's actually about dignity and agency. Right? And so ultimately, the fact that your clothes, for example, are not as strong as crypto with regard to something happening, that doesn't change the fact that we can live in a society where it's respected. The problem with a lot of the internet is that on the internet, you never know that someone has ripped off your clothes and robbed you of your dignity. So you need cryptography for that when you wish to have a say in it. And I don't think that this means that you can't have open organization. But we live in a world now where we have to recognize that the ability to overthrow a government through the internet, for example, is there. But it is also the case that when the government wants to do house-to-house rounding up of people, that's also there at the same time. And so we have to compartmentalize, and we have to recognize that not everything we do needs to compartmentalize away. But that if we don't learn from the past, like for example, I met some Argentinian revolutionaries from the Dirty War, and they told me how they organized. And I just imagined applying the surveillance systems of today to the Argentinian Dirty War's resistance. You could crush them in an afternoon with a Perl script. You know, you could do it with a terminal. Like you could say, here are the revolutionaries, here are where they live, go round these people up. And you know, you see this time and time again, actually. So it isn't the case that we have to encrypt everything and hide from each other. It's quite the opposite. We need to build a strong civil society with some of these technologies, but also we need to recognize that sometimes we aren't going to use that kind of protection because we are going to have that kind of freedom, but we're going to have some tampering that goes with it, or we're going to have some risk that goes with it. And we will never be completely safe, just as we will never be completely secure.
When
it comes to Tunisia, I think definitely the upcoming the draft constitution is a very big danger for everything that has been won during the revolutions, and we need to think about how we organize, because the people in activists that we talked to in Russia, they use strategies of radical openness not because they want to, because they feel they don't have any power against the FSB, and it's not empowering, it's just a fear strategy. But we also need to think that we haven't got that much good strategies to organize. We got mailing lists, which are not that empowering. I don't know what your experience is.
Who hates LinTech?
So we need to find ways on how to combine the on and the offline and do identity strategy there. Because when I'm sitting here, I know exactly what I would like to share and not would like to share. But when I'm on the internet, I have to get practically naked if I want to make use of a certain service.
Yes.
And so we need to make the internet into, or whatever model we find on which we want to organize, make it into a proper public space where we can negotiate our identity and make steps and with people that we trust and people we don't trust.
Trust. We are coming from a dictatorship. Trust is our problem. So let's say, speaking about Tunisians, but trust in this internet, in this area where we are faced with north and south policies, and we are here. It's incredible for me, for example, to be here with all of you speaking about freedom of internet after 2 years. Our revolution is completely bizarre, let's say. And here we are constructing trust. This is one of our, let's say, ways of touching other people and being together with Iranian people here in the same room and others. I don't know all of you, but this is the word. How can we organize if we were individuals before? We were like that. We weren't organized. We didn't work organized. And internet permitted us to be together without being together in a room, because we couldn't do that before. We cannot be in a room, let's say. It was a virtual area that created that trust, and we are creating it day after day.
And we have to be honest somehow about it, that after Marx, the left did not really come up with good structures to organize. So we need to rethink those structures, and we cannot just tell governments we got problems with hierarchy. We got problems with leadership, with leaderless movements. We got problems with consensus movements. Because if we're going to make everything a general assembly, nothing is going to move forward.
And now, I worked with Sami for years, trying to help him in any way with the Tunisian revolution. Like, I set up the directory authority, URAS, which is from the Ursula K. Le Guin novel, The Dispossessed. It's the imperfect world, it's not the anarchist planet, it's the other one. And, I set that up for Tunisia. It was specifically set up the way that it is to be able to get around Ben Ali's filter. And we worked for years together to be able to help to overthrow this dictatorship, right? I mean, it's so incredible. And now, the thing is that you guys have some of this power, and you can use some of this power to help the rest of us who have fallen into some pretty dark times now. And that, I think, is something which, this is actually an old principle which is forgotten, which is mutual aid and solidarity, standing together. And that's something which we absolutely need to find ways of expressing in the modern era. And I think a really big part of it is with national sovereignty. Like I said with Snowden, getting your country to make a statement of support. That's something which is like, we don't need a new structure to be able to do that. And it will actually help to improve the justice in this world, to improve the balance of justice, and also to reduce the amount of suffering that is taking place when someone tells us a great revelation. We also need new structures for organizing and for taking action. But we also need to take the current ones we have and really push them forward in the ways that we are currently not. And we don't see those things happening right now in some cases they are. But what they say is, it's not a secret law. There's no such thing as secret law. It's a secret interpretation of the law.
Right.
Well,
right.
And we need no secret law, and we need no secret interpretation, but we also need to ensure that we have open courts and non-military trials, for example. And these things, I don't think they're actually so radical. In fact, the most radical idea is that I hear you saying we should only be fighting for some of these things right now because of the
I'm not saying we need to be specific.
Yeah.
I'm not saying we shouldn't be fighting for, the ask shouldn't be big. I think we need to know what the ask is.
An actual open society is what we're asking for, where we have open courts, we have public laws, public interpretations, and public accountability, right? And we need a new church committee, but for the whole planet, not just for one country. That's a huge ask. Each country needs to have a church committee. Like when AIVD, the Dutch intelligence agency, is actually using some kind of API to pull data on Dutch residents from the NSA's database. And when GCHQ gets to do the same thing with full access, including pull everything on American citizens, each one of these countries has some serious reckoning to do about the quid pro quo trading that's going on. And we need to actually have some truth and reconciliation so that we can move forward. That, I think, is not a big ask. I think that that is much better than what will come if we do not have that, where we recognize that those secrets won't be kept from our enemies, and in fact, it will make an enemy of the population in many cases. If we design structures and systems that way to acknowledge that fact, I think we will have a much more robust and free world, which means secrets that last for a very short period of time, for example. The original guy that created classification in the United States specifically said that this was the intention and that the classification system has been abused. So even the people that accidentally created the clusterfuck we're living in right now, even though they did create it and did believe in that, they think it's just totally blown out of proportion.
Sure.
So what if we were to actually acknowledge that original thing and say, sure, there's some secrets, they last for a while, but long-term secrets are an example of an actual problem. You can see this with atomic weapons. If you have to keep the atomic weapons codes secret, for example, doesn't that suggest that maybe you have a pretty toxic thing on your hands that you have to spend a lot of resources protecting? It seems to be that we learned this with atomic war, for example, that that's not really something we want. We want to move towards disarmament. How we get there is anybody's question. But if we look at surveillance the way that we look at landmines, for example, and we look at secrecy the way that we look at atomic war, I think we can actually start to make some progress about the damage that it does to the whole of our society when we have these secrets and when we basically build everything around them, so much so that entire swaths of the population are completely excluded and become, in some cases, criminals, and you get a special class of people that are allowed to know. That's, I mean, you literally have an emergent phenomenon. The structure creates an emergent phenomenon of tyranny.
Because a lot of us, I mean, think about, you know, Facebook profiles becoming, you know, important social tools for how you interact, not necessarily professionally, but sometimes professionally. You know, we are complicit in the creation of our own archives, right? And that ephemerality or lack of ephemerality, you know, the notion that I see from a generation that's come up, you know, kind of, I guess the generation after I got online, that, oh, you kind of have one identity and it's tied to who you are in meat space. You know, these are social conventions that actively do us harm in the long run. You know, the notion that, you know, if you change careers, you know, every job, every interaction you had still follows with you. We can change those by the way that, you know, by the questions, the expectations that we ask of others. You know, do we expect to know the life stories of our close friends, or do we let them have secrets? You know, that radiates out into the world. And I think that it's not just the surveillance state where that shift is happening. That shift is happening socially too, and the two reflect and reinforce each other. If we make it unacceptable socially to have that kind of, you know, your entire life is tracked in public, and, you know, if we make that weird, we gain that privacy back in the social sphere. And that's gonna make it much more obvious. It's gonna make the violation much clearer to us all when we see the same thing happening in the surveillance sphere.
Some comments about what was said earlier, and we come back to what we said right now. So, are we well organized? Do we need to have infrastructure? talk tonight. I don't think it's a good idea. It's just, I think, sure, for sure, we need to evaluate the way we work. But I think the specificity of this community, activist community, is to be really pluralist. I mean, no leader, no chief. When we say that we need to be better organized, I mean, it's absolutely fantastic here, President Jacob, I know him from Twitter. Suddenly he's here in Nawaat, in a country where 3 years ago, if you ask common American people, where is Tunisia, no one will answer.
Some of us knew where Tunisia was before.
No, I'm not making
the hipster argument here. I'm saying many people here have read
about The way it is working, it's absolutely fantastic. It's amazing. Any minor fact happen anywhere in the world, all of us will hear about it. The fact that there are no any superstructure, this is really a guarantee for the pluralism of the priorities. People may think that this, a certain cause are really on the top of what we need to focus on. Other may have other priority, and that's really fantastic. This priority. And to defend the devil about security, two things. The first. Any one of us is in charge of the security, of the citizen security. That's totally normal that the guy will try to go further than the limit to succeed in his mission. And this is a human. So the problem is, those who this guy is protecting has to tell him, no, you stop there, guy. You stop there. And the second thing, There are no zero risk. And if you want to live in a society with the zero risk, there are solutions. You know, putting factories with chickens. The guy who is looking for the chicken. He's doing everything so that no harm will occur among his chicken. We're not chicken. We have to live with the risk. And you know. Every year, number of casualties, the number of people that die in the street is absolutely much more important than any terrorist victims. And so what we say, we will forbid any cars, we will not use any more cars. So in fact, what we did in Nawaat, for example, since years, even under Bernay, we were working on a special aspect. Democracy is not law, and we've been talking about laws. Now, what makes the laws having their impact is that feeling towards the public opinion between what is acceptable and what is unacceptable. And in 2000, 2002, 2004, since we started now, for example, about the censorship, believe us, we were working on that feeling. Yeah. It's not just about love, but we were working on the fact that the Tunisian public opinion will have to feel that what Ben Ali is doing with censorship is absolutely unacceptable. And all our work, all what we were doing was going in that direction. How to make really people feel that censorship is unacceptable. And with PRISM, just as I finish on this point, something really great, fantastic also happened, is just when we heard about what is happening, the public opinion, the work, all of you guys that were doing, it's absolutely huge. We see that very quick, it's this feeling, okay, everybody needs security, But there are parts that you should not transgress. But especially as Nazi Jago. I mean, of course, internet is a part of our life. Internet is part of our life. And we have also to recognize that there also, it's not only about tools, but also it's about education. It's about education to explain to our children, to our friends, that they have really to be very careful about what they do on the internet or what they don't do. And I mean, it's the only way, because internet is everywhere. And if we talk about privacy and saying that everything must be done about privacy, so the best thing is to block the internet. So there's also this dimension about education, about the fact that when you have a child in the street, you educate him because he is in danger. If he crosses the street without, without care, taking care about cars. So, voilà, this is what it's, and the finish, it's about this meaning among the public opinion about what is acceptable or not. And the guy who is in front of us, that he pretends, because sometimes it's not only about our security, and that he's pretending that he's looking for our security, saying no. I mean, there are certain limit that you cannot transgress. And there are some risks we have to live with it, otherwise we choose to be that chicken.
Yeah.
Hearing all of you guys talking, I'm from Syria, and hearing all of you talking about the internet freedom issues. Thank you so much. Hearing all of you guys talking about the freedom of internet and all, like what you want to see and what you are focusing on, I think I feel some kind of gap between what we are focusing on and what we should do, because I think I got this idea in the hard way. It's not about knowing anymore. It's about what we will do with this knowledge. Like, let's take Syria as an example. Now Syria is one of the biggest sources for the videos on YouTube. Like, the whole world now can watch what's happening in Syria, but the only word you can hear is, we don't know what's happening in Syria. So, is our goal is to just know, or is what we will do with this knowledge about like a global solidarity movement with some kind of causes? I'm not talking only about Syria, but I think our focus should not be only about like, is the internet free? Or are we free to use the internet? It's not an objective, or it's not a goal itself. It's about what we will do with this knowledge.
What's the point in fighting against this stuff? The cat's already out of the bag, the technology is already out there, it's already being used. What's the point? And I was trying to think of like why that didn't make sense to me, right? Like, why fundamentally I disagreed with it. And the analogy I ended up kind of giving back to, and I'm still not sure whether it's one I necessarily kind of stick to, but it's basically around weapons of mass destruction. Okay, we created technology that could destroy humanity. And it was only at that point, it was only at the point in which we realized we'd gone so far that we had to say the technology isn't the challenge, it's now what we think is right. And for me, that's where we're getting to. We're almost there now, where technology used to be the thing that stopped us. Technology used to be the thing that restrained us. But we've gone past that, and now policy has a role to play, because it's where society can say, no.
Even though we have proper reasons to.
I hear cynicism. I hear people saying that okay. Governments work, and other people are saying
but what we have tomorrow is a chance, as a group, to tell these people what we want.
Yeah.
So this is our audience. So we can later on think about ideas how we're going to take over the world and organize it in anarcho-syndicalistic ways, right? But let's first come up with what we want to say to these 21 countries and we want to have them live up to. And I think Eric made a really good setup, so let's try to make it a bit shorter so that it fits in 140 characters.
In a position from the US, and it's a country that has pretty bad interception and monitoring legislation. And I think an action for us is to demand more disclosure and to do more monitoring of that legislation and speak out against it. So I think there is a, I think this, we know this exists. It happens not just in the US, and I think what the US does influence the rest of the world, but maybe only by 25-30%. There's a lot of stuff that happens in the rest of the world, bad stuff, that is not actually directly linked to what happened in the US. I think what's so useful for us, those of us outside of the US, is that an exposure through Snowden's courage exposes not just what's happening in the US, it's what happens elsewhere as well. But we've got to tackle that, not just in expressing demands and criticizing the US government. We really have to look at what happens in our own state.